right. Well, good morning and welcome, everybody. Good to see everybody. Welcome. Morning down here. They're in a conversation, sorry. All right. Well, glad everybody's here and that we're together this morning. I know we have a few more coming in, so they'll be in soon, too. If I haven't had a chance to meet someone before, my name is Brian. I serve as the pastor of Citrus, and we're glad that you're here, especially if you're joining with us online, too. We'll say hi to everybody there. So I want to welcome everybody as we gather together for worship in the summertime. What I love about summer is that it's a different change of pace. It's a time to kind of refresh and regather myself after a busy school year or just a busy couple of months. And so for me, gathering together as the worshiping community gives me that opportunity. And so I hope that's our experience this morning as we gather, as a chance to be refreshed by the Spirit of God that's within each one of us as we gather. So any kind of just highlights, there's an orange card on your pew there. If you would like to share a prayer request or get involved in somehow or ask a question, you can use that. We'll collect those up later in the service during our offering time. But one of the ways that we get started a lot of times is by sharing together a psalm. So as you're able, I want to invite you to stand with me. We're going to put it up here on the screen. So this comes from Psalm 29. It's our call to worship for today, if you'll stand with me. And this one from Psalm 29 was one of the psalms that they would use, the Hebrews, to get started in worship. And it was one that if there was a kind of a note in there from the director, it would say, with enthusiastic voice, with loud voice, as a reminder to the people of God that we're gathering together in worship. So I want to extend that note to you with enthusiastic voice. I want to invite you to join your voice with mine on the part that says all. The voice of the Lord flashes flames of fire. Give credit to the Lord for glory and strength. The voice of the Lord shakes the wilderness. Worship the Lord with holy awe and wonder. The Lord sits enthroned as leader forever. In God's congregation, we all say glory. Amen. Jared and Deb will lead us as we worship this morning. I invite you to sing along as you're comfortable. Let's worship the Lord.
Hi. So, as many of you know, as some of you may know, we are currently doing a series on the book of Isaiah. And it turns out, like, Isaiah was a bit of a songwriter. So, this morning, all the songs we sing are inspired by this verse, by this chapter from Isaiah 12. And in my Bible, it is also titled A Song of Praise. And it says, on that day you will say, I will give thanks to you, Lord. Although you were angry with me, your anger has turned away, and you have comforted me. Indeed, God is my salvation. I will trust in him and not be afraid, for the Lord himself, is my strength and song. He has become my salvation. You will joyfully draw water from the springs of salvation, and on that day you will say, give thanks to the Lord, proclaim his name. Make his works known among the peoples. Declare that his name is exalted. Sing to the Lord, for he has done glorious things. Let this be known throughout the earth. Cry out and sing, citizens of Zion, for the Holy One of Israel is among you in his greatness.
Your name in all the earth. We behold the breaking dawn, the light that shines over everyone. We look to you, we long for you, oh Lord. We behold the rising sun, the earth awakes. Your hope has come, we look to you, we long for you, oh Lord. Oh, our Lord, oh, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. We behold the falling rain, like waters rise, flood this place, we reach thee, we cling to you, oh Lord. Oh, our Lord, oh, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. Oh, our Lord, oh, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. Majestic is your name in all the earth. Strength and song, highest praise to him belongs. Christ the Lord, the Holy King, your name we raise, your triumph sing. And praise the Lord, our true salvation. Praise the Lord, the glorious one. By his hand we stand in victory, by his name we overcome. Though the storms of life pursue, in darkest night we worship you. You divide the raging sea, from death to life you safely lead. Praise the Lord, our true salvation. Praise the Lord, the glorious one. By his hand we stand in victory, by his name we overcome. The saints and angels bow, host of heaven crying, glory, glory to the King, your reign for all eternity. Praise the Lord, our true salvation. Praise the Lord, the glorious one. By his hand we stand in victory, by his name we overcome. Praise the Lord, our true salvation. Praise the Lord, the glorious one. By his hand we stand in victory, his name we overcome.
This won't be on the screen, but I think we know it.
Come thou fount of every blessing to my heart to sing thy grace. Streams of mercy never ceasing, call for songs of loudest praise. Teach me some melodious song sung by flaming tongues above. Praise the mountain fixed upon it, mount of thy redeeming love. Praise the mountain fixed upon it, mount of thy redeeming love.
If you'll join me in prayer. Lord, we're thankful for this opportunity to gather together and worship. We're thankful that you've brought us here and that you are our true salvation, and that when life pursues, you are there to guide us as we go through anything we're facing. We pray that you bless this time that we have together, and that we be that you be with Brian as he delivers your word, and that you open our hearts to your word. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.
And while you're still standing, I want to invite you to say hi to some folks around you. If you don't know someone, introduce yourself, share your first name. And for the kiddos, feel free to move across and meet Miss Crystal. All right. Once you meet some folks, feel free to be seated. Again, I want to welcome everybody. If we haven't had the chance to meet before, my name is Brian. I serve as the pastor here at Citrus, and I'm glad that we're gathering together today. This morning, as we're continuing in worship, we're beginning to look at the book of Isaiah together. We just got into this last week, so if you weren't here for that one, no fear. I'll catch you up on that. Basically, what we've been doing is looking through the books of the Bible, and we're coming to Isaiah. And Isaiah really kicks off the section for us on the prophets. And what I shared last week was that prophets, sometimes we think of them as fortune tellers, like people who can tell the future. But in all reality, what they were was truth tellers. And they were the kind of people who told the truth of what was coming next. They were what we might call the early warning systems of their day. When things were going bad, when things were getting out of whack in Israel, the prophets would be people sent by God to warn the kings and the people and the rulers to say, hey, not a good direction. Like, let's turn the boat. Let's go a different way. And sometimes they were heard, and sometimes they weren't. And that becomes what one of my favorite theologians calls the sawtooth history of Israel, where you get these kind of peaks and valleys. And so we're looking at the book of Isaiah and getting a sense for what Isaiah's message was. And Isaiah is often described as a book of judgment and hope. And I think it's important to keep those together because judgment by itself doesn't lead very far. And hope, if we think of it just as kind of like a pie in the sky, everything's great and getting better, we know the realities of that too. But somehow Isaiah brings together both this judgment and this hope, and somehow that becomes for us good news. So we'll look together at that this morning. But I wanted to start us with a quote from John Oswald, who writes on the book of Isaiah, because I think this will help to frame where we're going both today and for the rest of the series. And it's this: God does not reveal himself to destroy us, but rather to redeem us. I think this is important for us to keep in view as we look at a book like Isaiah, where it begins to take some very dramatic and drastic turns, where things look bleak at best. And it seems to be that the bleakness comes as God reveals God's self to the people. But it's a good reminder for us that the reason God shows up is not to let us know everything that we've always done wrong, but to redeem us and to show us the hope and the possibility of life that can be. So this morning, we're going to look at one of the more popular chapters in the book of Isaiah, chapter 6. Last week, we looked at chapter 1. This week is chapter 6. And I'm going to kind of take us through a verse-by-verse, so to speak, understanding of it. So we're going to be looking this morning at chapter 6, verse 1. We'll read through all of it, but we'll take our time through it. Again, my hope with this is that we really begin to understand what God is doing here. And so it begins with this statement. In the year of King Uzziah's death, I saw the Lord. Now, the I there is Isaiah. This is Isaiah's testimony. I saw the Lord sitting on a high and exalted throne, the edges of his robe filling the temple. And so we begin looking at this here, and there's this phrase here, in the year of King Uzziah's death, and I think at a very simplistic term, what Isaiah is trying to do in the writing down of this is to say, here's the time stamp. It's like when you send a letter to the post office and they postmark it, you know when it arrived and when it was sent. And what this is trying to do is to locate this experience, which we'll see in a minute, is a very out-of-body experience for Isaiah. He's trying to locate it in the real world. It kind of holds in tension that idea of the God who stands above everything that is happening, but also the reality that we live in every day. And so King Uzziah was one of the good kings of Israel. Some were good, some were bad, some kind of flipped the script as they went through. And Uzziah was one of the good ones. He was one who brought together a strong sense of administration for the people of Israel, gathered together their military and to strengthen their military, and really allowed the kingdom to grow and to prosper. And so not only is Isaiah trying to date this would be about 742 BCE, but I think he's also trying to get us to understand the mindset of the people. And I think this will make sense to us. In the time of King Uzziah, everything was going well. The administration was good, the military was strong, the people were growing. And you could look around this southern kingdom of Israel and you could say, hey, we're doing pretty good. And then the king dies. So people will begin to wonder, who's next, right? Will we have someone as good as we had before? We can see this in our own lives. Whenever there's a changing of administration, whether it's at a national or a local, or even a place like we are, a school level, when administration shifts over, we ask the question, what's next? Maybe it's a hopeful one if we didn't like the direction before. But in Israel's case, things were going well. And so my sense is there's this unease among the people of Israel to say, you know, will the next king be as good as who we have now? Will we continue to grow and prosper? Will we be able to keep out our enemies? And so, of course, when there's those kinds of transitions, us, like the people there, would begin to feel uneasy. I think Isaiah wants us to understand this. Perhaps what it seems like to Isaiah is they'd put a lot of hope in their human leaders. And maybe because the human leaders were doing so well with God's help, they'd forgotten the God who stood behind them. And their trust began to be, our success is based off of these human things. And they'd forgotten the sense in which who they were was shaped by the God who stood behind the kings and all the leaders and the prophets. And so I think part of what Isaiah's message to the people is going to be is whether the king is good or the king is bad, the Lord stands with us. The Lord is behind Israel. And he wants them to understand that in this pending crisis that they assume is coming, of whoever's next, that God will still be with them. Now, I don't know how crises go in your life, but it seems to me that much like the people of Israel, when times are good, then my prayer life is average. My connection with God is average. Again, not intentionally. But when crisis comes up, when something begins to go wrong, the prayers ascend. The scripture is read more frequently. And I don't offer that as an example. I offer that as a way of saying, I think it's our human nature that when things are going well, we tend to think, you know what? All is well in the land. When crisis crops up, that's when we say, oh, that's right, Lord, I need your help. I need you to show up. And it always was the case with Israel too. When times were good, They kind of did their own thing. When times were bad, they cried out to the Lord. I try not to hold that over their head because I see the same pattern in my life and honestly in our lives together. I think it's just the up and down nature of human life. But the reality is that Isaiah saw was that the people were moving into a time of potential crisis of who's next. And because of that, they were looking for answers. And Isaiah recognizes now is a time to once again invite the people to return to the Lord, to turn their hearts back from all the things and all the idols and all the stuff that they had gathered to their source. And so Isaiah has this vision. He doesn't conjure it up for himself. It just simply happens where he says, I saw the Lord seated on a high and exalted throne, the edges of his robe filling the temple. And I want to give us a sense of what this might have been like for him. And I want to share a couple of pictures from Israel. This is modern day Jerusalem. You probably recognize the Golden Dome. This would also be the Temple Mount. And so it's not 100% sure where everything lies, but the temple of the Hebrew people would have been in this same spot, potentially even kind of centered underneath here. These are the original steps that Jesus would have walked up and down in his day. And so the structure remains there. And so this becomes kind of a central piece here. This is the temple space. So just to give you kind of a geography of where we're thinking. Now I want to rewind the tape back. The temple that a lot of us may have seen pictures of is one that's actually built later in the time. It's Herod's temple. It's the one that we know of. The temple that Isaiah would have been referring to would have been a smaller one. Solomon's temple that was built, this was the first one before it was destroyed. And so this is the space where he has this vision of what's happening. Now this is a photograph that was taken on that day, and thankfully they had photographs, cameras available, and we could do this cross-section. Very helpful. An artist's rendering of what the temple might have looked like in Isaiah's time. And so his vision, he says, in the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord sitting on a high and exalted throne. And so there's different levels. There's the outer courtyard, there's this inner sanctuary, and then there's the Holy of Holies where only the priest of the year could go. And if you remember from history or from Indiana Jones, there's an Ark of the Covenant. And that would have been really the central place. That would have been what they called the throne room. And it was understood that God's presence resided over top of this area. And so only one person could go in. There's oftentimes a rope tied around them because the belief was to see God face to face would just kind of cause a human to die. And so if that happened, they would have to pull the priest out. And so what Isaiah sees is not this room with the Ark of the Covenant, but he sees that somehow transformed into a throne where the presence of God is seated, where God is exalted. And so he has this, what we call a theophany, a vision of God present in this holy space. And he goes on to say that his robe filled the temple. And so to the best of our imaginations, we try to link our imagination to capture the amazing splendor of this event where God's presence fills us in such a way where the entire space is just filled with this royal robe, and it just creates this entire moment of God's presence. I don't know exactly what that would have looked like, but my guess was that the sense of time and space becomes relative, because for Isaiah, he's not just standing in the temple, but he can see the presence of God in the temple. And as I read this verse, what I began to think about is this is very ornate and beautiful and looks like a worshipful space. But I think that whether we anticipate it or not, that my hope each week is when we gather, that the presence of the Lord descends in such a way where maybe we can begin to see God with us. And maybe it's too much of a stretch, but maybe it's not, that we could begin to imagine that when we gather together and worship, that the hymn, that the robe of God begins to fill this cafeteria. And the presence of God is with us. And sometimes that becomes hard to see, because when I look around, I see the markings, not of a temple, but of a cafeteria. And you know, and we begin to get this challenging thing. But My hope is always that when we gather together, that we're gathering in a holy space in the same way that Isaiah did. And we can't fabricate that, and we wouldn't want to. But I think Isaiah's thing was that he was open to what God was doing and began to see not through just the eyes that we have, but through the spiritual eyes of our heart to say, God, what are you doing in this place? And how is your Holy Spirit in this space and filling this space and filling us? And so maybe it's asking a lot of us, but I want to invite us to think about ourselves when we gather in this space as God's people gathering in God's presence. And maybe it doesn't look just like that, but it's a holy space nonetheless. And so here we have this visual manifestation, which is seemingly strange and not something probably that many of us have really ever experienced. But when we look back at scriptures, we see the same thing again. We see Moses encountering a burning bush that's not consumed, the presence of God. We see Israel in the desert when there's a cloud in the day, and then there's a pillar of fire by night, this visible demonstration of God with us. And these kind of divine encounters, I think by their very nature, have to be unplanned. They have to be uncoerced, and they're probably unexpected. They oftentimes will serve in Scripture as a time when the person who experiences it feels a deep sense of call and commission to what God has put before them to do. And so maybe this is a little bit odd to us, because here we are in chapter 6, and Isaiah has already done a lot of talking, and it seems like now he's being called and commissioned on behalf of the Lord to go and to say these true things to the people of God. Now, some read this as an experience that he may have had before, and there was some earlier writing from chapters 1 through 5. Maybe others think that he was already kind of doing the Lord's work, and then God offered him this call. I think this quite simply just recognizes that there's a lot of questions in there, and sometimes God's plans in our lives, it doesn't always kind of offer a nice little linear pathway. But what we can clearly see here is that this is Isaiah's call story. And he goes on to describe it a little bit more, and I want to share some more of that in verses 2 through 4. He says, winged creatures were stationed around him. Each had 6 wings. And this is a good example for us. Just allow your imagination to fill in these details. With 2, they veiled their faces, with 2, their feet, and with 2, they flew about. They shouted to each other, saying, holy, holy, holy is the Lord of heavenly forces. All the earth is filled with God's glory. The door frame shook at the sound of their shouting, and the house was filled with smoke. Again, this is that same picture that we just saw there. We're talking about the door frames and the house, the winged creatures. And Isaiah has this vision. And the interesting thing is our translation calls them winged creatures. And that's just kind of bland. These were actually seraphim, if you've ever heard that word before. And their other nickname, kind of from Hebrew, it's a meaning of a word of fiery creature. So these were fiery creatures that were surrounding the throne, whose job and whose ministry was kind of offering praise to God. And I think anytime we see fire in the Bible, as I just mentioned, the pillar of fire, or Moses in the burning bush, Isaiah's experience with these fiery creatures, fire was always a symbol of God's presence. It was always kind of an aha moment that God is here. In some ways, this is why we have candles to remind us. Fire reminds us of God present with us. We use these visual cues so we don't just think that we're gathering in a cafeteria, right? So we remember that God is with us. And this also becomes a prelude that we will see later as we think about the Holy Spirit. Today in the life of the church is Pentecost. And on Pentecost, we remember that many years later, another fire shows up. It says, when Pentecost day arrived, they, the disciples, were all together in one place. Suddenly a sound from heaven, like the howling of a fierce wind, filled the entire house where they were sitting. Do you hear the same parts of that? They saw what seemed to be individual flames of fire alighting on each one of them. They were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other languages as the Spirit enabled them to speak. Another example, and yet, the difference in this one is It's not just one person. It's not just Isaiah. It's all the believers. It's all of us. Every one of us now has this call and this commission. That's getting a little bit ahead of ourselves. So we'll continue looking at Isaiah. But what we see here, once again, is they were all together. There was sound, there was probably singing, there was worshiping together. And once again, I want to simply invite us to imagine what this kind of gathering might have looked like for us to have been there. So I want to take us back to Isaiah. We'll pick up again in verse 5, and I want to read some more of Isaiah's call story. Because after he experiences this amazing worshipful moment with God, he has a moment where he turns inwards and remembers, oh wait, I know who I am. And he says to himself, mourn for me, I am ruined. I am a man with unclean lips, and I live among a people with unclean lips. Yet I've seen the King, the Lord of heavenly forces. One of the winged creatures flew to me holding a glowing coal that he'd taken from the altar with tongs. He touched my mouth and said, see, this has touched your lips. Your guilt has departed. Your sin is removed. I want to remind us at the beginning of that quote, God doesn't show up just to judge and smite, but to redeem and to purify and to make us holy and to remind us that God is present with us. And in this particular passage, we see this show up a couple times where Isaiah's concern is that he has unclean lips, right? And that seems to be the piece where he's really just feels like in the presence of God, that's where his sin, as he would say, is. And so once again, we see that fire, that purification element, when the glowing coal comes and touches his lips as a way of purifying them and offering him forgiveness. We talked about this in our Proverbs series a few weeks back, but whenever we think about this idea of unclean lips, maybe we don't think as much about that, but for the Israelites, if you remember, that speech for them was always a representation of what was in their heart. And so whatever was in their heart, good, bad, or indifferent, would come out through their speech. I think we know that to be true for us too. And so for Isaiah, what he was really upset about was not what he was saying or what was coming out of his mouth. He began to get this sense of Lord, there's things inside of me that I want you to purify. And I think what it reminds me is that Isaiah is a person called of God. Isaiah is a prophet. And if a prophet feels like there's more work God can do inside of them, then how much more true is that for me? This passage reminds me that our life in Christ is not just about a date of salvation or coming to faith once, but it's a continual journey of faith where we're constantly seeking the Lord, asking, Lord, purify whatever it is inside of me that I may better serve you and your people. And so Isaiah becomes what I call a micro example for Israel. He becomes the first example of what God can do. So if God can do this with Isaiah, then God can purify the people of Israel as a whole. And I always think that's interesting because sometimes when God picks Israel or people today or me today, I think to myself, you pick the worst possible representative, right? Sometimes people have a hang up, not really with Jesus, but with the church, and for good reason. And I always wonder, you know, Lord, in all the great ideas you had, you chose to work through a community of people who we know are sinners, right? We know, or we ought to know better than anyone else, that we don't have it all together. Why does God choose to work through imperfect people? I think it's just because it displays God's grace in amazing ways. It's always been said that a church should never be a sanctuary of saints, but a hospital of sinners. And I think that's what Isaiah is getting at here, is all of us need this reminder of what it means to have life in Christ. And so Isaiah will go on in verse 8, and he says, then I heard the Lord's voice saying, whom should I send, and who will go for us? I love this. And I said, here, I'm here, send me. For many people over the generations, Isaiah 6 has been an echo of their own call story. A divine moment in their life when they sense God calling them to something significant. And perhaps like Isaiah, they felt totally unworthy. And yet somehow being in God's presence and receiving that affirmation and forgiveness of God, they were willing to say, you know what, Lord, send me. I'm willing to go. And sometimes we define that very narrowly, and we think that a passage like this applies to those who primarily occupy the on-pulpit places, right? That these are things reserved for pastors or for missionaries. I want to remind us that both here in Isaiah and in the New Testament, this was for all people, every one of us. And what's happening here is Isaiah's call would become Israel's call. It was a call for the people. But when Pentecost happened and the Spirit came, the Spirit didn't just come to the 12 disciples and decide to leave everyone else alone. It came upon all the believers and every believer after that. And so I want to remind each one of us that each of us stands in the same stream where we hear the Lord's voice calling us in some way to do something or to be someone, and we have that opportunity to say, you know, here I am, Lord, send me. Those are always exciting moments. For Isaiah afterwards, though, here's what he just signed up for. Go and say, God said, go and say to this people, listen intently, but don't understand. Look carefully, but don't comprehend. Make the minds of this people dull. Make their ears deaf and their eyes blind, so that they can't see with their eyes or hear with their ears or understand with their minds, and turn and be healed. I said, how long, Lord? And God said, until cities lie ruined with no one living in them, until there are houses without people and the land is devastated. The Lord will send the people far away and the land will be completely abandoned. Even if one-tenth remain there, they will be burned again, like a terebinth or an oak, which when it's cut down, leaves a stump. Its seed is a holy seed. Its stump is a holy seed. I wonder if Isaiah's hand kind of got a little lower after that one. Like, oh, I thought the message would have been different. It was a message of judgment by God upon Israel. They had spent so long not following and not doing things and putting their trust in human leaders and in kings and in rulers that they had really just lost sight in so many ways of who God was for them and their call to be a blessing to the nations. And so Isaiah, who just volunteered, now has this message to deliver. And it reminds me that the call of God upon our lives puts us into uncomfortable situations. It doesn't put us into situations where we get to be blessed to call out the sins of others. Oftentimes what it does is calls us to maybe be the one who's standing when everything else is kind of going in one direction. To be the one who says, hold on, let's not go that way. To be the one who tells the truth. To be the one who shares their faith when it's unpopular. Isaiah walks in that understanding and that tradition. What I love about this passage is how it ends. We've just had several verses of judgment, right? But remember, Isaiah is a book not just of judgment, but hope. In this last line right here, you could almost miss it. Its stump is a holy seed. And so what we see here is that even though Israel has broken the covenant, they've chosen a different way, they've kind of gone off the playbook that God offered to them, God hasn't just given up. In this vision, there's almost this vision of everything being cut down, everything being leveled, everything kind of being burned. And yet, God says, within this stump, there's a holy seed. And I don't know if it was divine coincidence or not, but last weekend we watched the movie The Lorax. Has anyone seen The Lorax? I probably should have read the book. Liam, if you'll take me to that first one, please. Because maybe the book's different than the movie? Okay. So I'm going with the movie on this one. But what really inspired me was we watched this together as a family, and it was one of those movies where we thought, well, this will be cute. The kids watch it in school. And by the end, I think I was like, okay, that hits different. If you haven't seen it, it's worth taking time to watch. What I love about this was the Lorax opens up with the scene of the perfect land. If you could imagine Eden or heaven or the most beautiful kind of natural sanctuary, that was the land that's presented to us. Again, I'm working off of the movie. If the book is different, I'll try and read that this week, and hopefully it doesn't change everything. But there was this perfect land, and then the onceler shows up and begins to cut down the first tree so they can take this truffula tree and make it into, what was the word for it? A sneed. Yes, a sneed, which is a thing that everyone needs. And so he makes this sneed and eventually becomes popular, and people begin to buy it, so he cuts down more and more trees, and slowly we can see the onceler is missing it. All the trees are coming down. We're seeing a lot more stumps, and we finally come to the last tree. And you look out upon what was once a beautiful land, and it's desolate. Stumps, everything is dry and gray. All the animals have left. But because of greed and opportunity, the last tree comes down, and now there's nothing left. We fast forward the story, and that beautiful utopia has turned into a plastic city. And I'm watching this, and I'm realizing, like, oh, like, I get this, right? I see the prophecy of the Lorax. I get it. I mean, we have lived in a community, and we've only been here 5 years. Many of you have been here a lot longer. You've seen the Lorax story take place here in this area of orange trees that died out and came down, of pine trees that stood tall and have come down. And I enjoy the progress, and I'm not the one who's standing up here saying, like, no more people. I think it's a little hypocritical to say, like, I'm here, but now no one else should come to this area because there's a lot of people, right? There's a hypocrisy in that. But we've seen these changes, and so we can relate to this kind of story. And what I love about the story is the boy shows up, a young boy shows up, and he's given the gift of one seed. And we begin to think, what difference can one seed make? The story changes, the story unfolds, it comes together. He's able to plant the seed. And we begin to see in a couple of months or years that there's new little truffula trees coming up next to where the stumps used to be. It doesn't pretend like everything has been fixed, but it shows us, I think, an amazing picture of redemption. Israel had basically clear-cut their life by abandoning God. And so as Isaiah looks out, he's in this temple experience, he looks out, and Israel is just clear cut. And yet, in that stump remains a holy seed. And of course, this would become some of the language that they would use to speak of Jesus. Isaiah will speak of him later too. A holy seed that comes forth from the stump. That's why, for this series, what I chose as kind of a background image was a stump with a seed coming out of it, because this is the kind of hope that Isaiah is offering. A reminder that the Lord isn't done with them or us yet. So in the Lorax, the caution is, a tree falls the way it leans. Be careful which way you lean. And I'm not sure, again, if Dr. Seuss, or was that Dr. Seuss who did that one? Wrote it having read Isaiah, or maybe it was just one of those coincidences. But I think we can certainly see this idea here really playing out in both the movie and Isaiah, that God shows up not to destroy us, but to redeem us. And so when Israel has laid waste to their lives, to their spiritual life, to their community, later in the book of Isaiah, they'll eventually come to the place where they're defeated by enemy nations, and all of Israel is carried off into exile. And yet, there is a holy seed. And so in Isaiah, what I hear is a word of hope. And I want to invite us to allow that holy seed to take root in our lives in whatever way we most need it. Last week, we gathered together in a circle, and we prayed in response to the mass shooting that had happened. And I think I read this morning on the news, there's been one every day since. And so, as we see our land and our country somewhat clear-cut by these kind of things, what is the holy seed that can begin to bring forth redemption from all of this literal brokenness and death? Maybe it's on a different level. Maybe it's on a more personal level for us. Where in our lives do we feel like it's just been clear-cut? And maybe that happens intentionally, where maybe we have wandered away from God, or we've just spent enough time away from God. But at least I know in my life, a lot of times it's just unintentional. Things are maybe going well, and I'm not really paying as much attention. Maybe you've moved here recently, and life has kind of gotten flipped over and upside down, and you feel like everything that you knew has been clear-cut, and you're starting over. And so I want to invite us again to find that seed of holy hope that God plants within each one of us to say, despite how it may look around us, there is good news. There is good news. And I think what struck me the most in the Lorax, the movie, was the original Lorax creature, the little orange thing, is the one who speaks for the trees. And I'm sure you caught it. At the end, the Lorax isn't around. It's the boy who shows up with the seed, and the boy says, I speak for the trees. And I think somehow that's God's call for us there. We hear Isaiah saying, I speak for the Lord, but each one of us now carries that seed, and we have the choice to raise our hand and to say, I speak for the Lord. And I don't speak in a way that judges you as different from me. I speak in a way that hopefully offers that holy seed of hope to the next person. It says, I see you. I understand where you're at. Here is a seed of hope of what God can do. And so I want to invite us to think about where we are in our journeys. Whether we're awaiting our call of what God has for us next, I want to encourage us to seek God's presence. Not for what we could get out of it or get out of God, but just for the sake of being with God. And maybe you feel the same objection I do sometimes, like, Lord, who am I? Like, who am I to offer this hope to someone else? Right? I know me. I know the things I've done. I know all those things. And once again, the Lord comes to us and purifies us time and time again and calls us to go. And so I want to invite us to think of the ways that we might say, Lord, here I am, send me. In the language from the Lorax, I speak for the Lord. How might we take up the call to do justice, to love mercy, and to extend compassion? Because I think that's what our world is looking for. That comes from the book of Micah, where we're called to do justice and to love kindness and to offer compassion to all. Because we remember that what it was really about was not Israel being the top nation because they had God on their side. Israel was always positioned that way so they could be a blessing to every other nation around them. They were going to be the spokespeople, the light of the world. And so how might we carry that light with us this week? And so what I want to invite us to reflect on this morning as we get ready to share communion is this passage in verse 8. And again, as best we can imagine in a cafeteria, that is obviously a cafeteria, how might this become a holy space for us this morning? Where like Isaiah, we can hear this question posed to us. Whom should I send, and who will go for us? Let's keep that question in our hearts and our minds today as we receive. I want to remind us that none of us are beyond God's love. All of us are included in this call and commission of God. That each one of us has a plan and a purpose for our lives. And it probably won't take you, it may take you into this kind of pastoral role, but really and truly, I want to emphasize this. God has you already in a place where God can use you. Your work, your life, your play, your neighbors, your community. We can shine light in those places with that holy seed. So let's take a moment together and pray. And we'll close with the Lord's Prayer, and then we'll share together in communion. God, as we gather this morning, we give thanks for your presence with us this morning. If we haven't had a chance to sense you with us yet, may that become real to us in the breaking of the bread and in the drinking of the juice. May we see you as we gather around this table. And may we have the audacity to believe that you have a plan for each one of us, that you have a way that each one of us can share light, a way that only we can do. And Lord, we have objections and concerns, and we have questions and doubts, and you're good with all those. You see all those, and yet you have called each one of us in the same. So empower us on this Pentecost morning to be a Spirit-led people who are sent out into this community to shine light. We ask this in Jesus' name, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who've trespassed against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Well, this morning we have a chance, as I shared, to gather together around the Lord's table. And we remember that this was the practice of Jesus to share meals together. And so we share this meal together too. So on the night that Jesus gathered his disciples together, he took the bread, gave thanks to God, he broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and invited them to take and eat. For this is the body of Christ that has been broken for you. And after the supper was finished, he took the cup and gave thanks to God, gave it to his disciples, and invited them to drink from this. For this is the blood of the new covenant that's been poured out for you and for many and for all of us. So this is the forgiveness of sins through Jesus. And so as often as we eat this bread and drink this cup, we remember and we rehearse this meal of Jesus. And so what we have as our practice this morning is, in just a moment, I'll invite you to come forward. What I'd like for you to do is, if we can just start with the front rows, as each of the front rows make their way up, feel free to come down these center aisles and make your way back around. Watch out for cords on this aisle here. If you would like, as you come up, I will offer you a piece of bread. So just hold your hands out like this. I'll place the bread in your hand. And then we have individual cups over there. If you would prefer a more sealed up way, that's perfectly fine too. Just feel free to grab one of these sealed containers with the bread and the juice in it. Everything that we serve is Welch's grape juice on that part. And we do have the gluten-free option here with the bread that's in the cups, if that's what you need. And so here at Citrus Church, as a United Methodist Church, one of the things that's really important to us is that this isn't just our table, that this is Jesus' table. And so if you're a part of this church, you're welcome. If you're not a part of this church, you're welcome. All are welcome at this table. Anyone who would like to participate is invited. So I'll invite you to come as you're ready. Jared and Deb will lead us in music.
Spirit, pour out and flood this city. Heaven, come down and shake the walls. Fill us, Lord, the world is waiting. God, let your kingdom come. Come, restore. Generations of desolation, bind up the poor and broken heart, plant and sow, till and grow where time has ravaged, break down the walls of race and war. Spirit, pour out and flood this city. Heaven, come down and shake the walls. Fill us, Lord, the world is waiting. God, let your kingdom come. God, we see peace and welfare for our city. Prosper, Redeemer, as you are. That all will see your glory and greater majesty. Through us, your church, your kingdom come. Spirit pour out and flood this city. Heaven come down and shake the walls. Fill us, Lord, the world is waiting. God, let your kingdom come. Spirit pour out and flood this city. Heaven come down and shake the walls. Fill us, Lord, the world is waiting. God, let your kingdom come.
If you would like, you can stand and join as we continue to sing.
You are the God who builds. You are the one who saves. You are the God who prospers. Evil has no claim. You are the God who builds. You are the one who saves. You are the God who prospers. Fervently we pray. You are the God who builds. You are the one who saves. You are the God who prospers. Evil has no claim. You are the God who builds. You are the one who saves. You are the God who prospers. Fervently we pray. Spirit pour out and flood this city. Heaven come down and shake the world. Fill us, Lord, the world is waiting. God, let your kingdom come. Spirit pour out and flood this city. Heaven come down and shake the walls. Fill us, Lord, the world is waiting. God, let your kingdom come. Spirit pour out and flood this city. Heaven come down and shake the walls. Fill us, Lord, the world is waiting. God, let your kingdom come. Spirit pour out and flood this city. Heaven come down and shake the walls. Fill us, Lord, the world is waiting. God, let your kingdom come.
It's a new song for us, but that line in there, God, the world is waiting. And I think that just reminds us once again of the invitation, the opportunity for us to be a part of the work that God is doing in the world, which to me is both exciting and scary, right? That we would be a part of this, those who help to shine light and plant seeds of hope and change. So I want to invite you to be seated for just a moment. I want to share a couple things that are coming up at Citrus on our rundown. And so if you are new here, maybe it's your first time or you're new, we have a gift for you at the orange table if you'll stop there on the way out, a gift that we can offer to you. If you've got any questions, you can ask those there. We don't have our new fridge sheets out. Those will be out next week, but we'll have some opportunities coming up for this summer. One of the things that you'll find on there is we have a Galatians Bible study that we started last Wednesday, which was a lot of fun. But we formatted it so that you can kind of come when you can during the summer. So it's last Wednesday, it's this Wednesday, and next Wednesday. So if you want to pop in for that study, we'd love to have you on Wednesday. Also, coming up, we've got a couple of meetups. So if you've got kids and or youth and you're looking for some things to do during the summer for your sanity, I mean for fun, these will be a lot of fun. We've got bowling, splash pad, fire station, and more. Some for the little kids, some for the older kids. You can check out all those at todayatcitrus.org and find the signups for the ones that'll work for you. So be sure to check those out. Next Sunday, right after worship, we're setting up for Vacation Bible School. Whoop, whoop. Excited. And so after worship finishes, we're going to hang around for about an hour and a half to get this place ready for our week of camp. So if that sounds like something you'd like to help out with, feel free to hang out after worship next week. We'll have some pizza and stuff for lunch, too, if you get hungry. And then in two Sundays, on the 19th, is our VBS Sunday, where the kids will get to share all the things that they've been learning and doing in the last week. It'll really be their Sunday to lead us in worship. It's also Father's Day, and we thought that was a great reason, if we need an excuse, to have a root beer float Sunday available to all. So we'll do that Sunday also, just to make it a fun way to gather together and worship. That's the 19th. The last thing I want to mention is our celebration lunch for Crystal. Crystal's our children's director, and with the changing of the school year, she'll be stepping down from that role. She'll still be a part of our church, and so we're celebrating her. It's not a surprise, so you don't have to worry about kind of breaking the news. Her husband is here. We're all in the know. But what we're doing, I think, is going to be a lot of fun. So after worship, on the 27th of this month, we're going to go to Orange County National. It's the golf course kind of right here by the Summer Lake area. They've got a room in there, so we'll have order off the lunch menu and just have a time to kind of celebrate Crystal. They've got a beautiful little outside area where kids can play too. So make sure to put that on your calendar. It'll be in the emails coming up in the following week, but make sure that's on your calendar for the 26th, which is the Sunday at the end of the month. But if you will, I want to invite you to stand as you're able. I want to offer a blessing for our week ahead. I want to invite you to receive this blessing. The God who made this amazing universe is creating you anew each day. Jesus Christ, the resurrected one, offers you a peace that never dies. The Holy Spirit is setting your hearts on fire right here, right now. So go in peace and be transformed, that you may participate in transforming the world. Amen.